anyone here what it was awarded for? I heard three people got it. That's fine. Yeah. So graphene, and graphene is kind of this neat material that's only been around for about the last 6 years or so when these guys developed it. It's similar to graphite, which is in pencils. Chemically, it's very similar. It's a form of carbon, except graphene is only one atom thick, and it conducts electricity, and it's very strong. It's actually one of the strongest materials that we know about. I don't think it's superconducting, but it does conduct electricity, which is pretty neat. There's actually kind of some neat stories about the guy who developed it. There were two people. There was a guy who I think he was already a professor at that point, but maybe not. But also his student. They both were awarded the Nobel Prize. But the older guy, Geim, I think is how you pronounce his name. I think he may be the only guy to have won a Nobel Prize and an Ig Nobel Prize as well. I don't know if you've heard of this. The Ig Nobel Prizes are awarded for kind of goofy, off-the-wall research that some people don't think should even be funded because some of it's so out there. But Geim actually was awarded the Ig Nobel Prize a few years ago for using really powerful magnets to levitate a frog. The magnet was so powerful it polarized, it induced a polarization in the atoms of in the molecules of the frog, and it was powerful enough to levitate this guy. I've heard, and I haven't verified this one, but I've heard he's also listed a hamster as a co-author on one of his papers. He's kind of a character. But he and his student developed this material called graphene about 6 years ago, and it's really taken off. It's way outside my field. It has nothing to do with particle physics, as far as I know. But I know there's, what's that? Not true? Nothing that I know about yet. We should talk afterwards if you know something about it. We'll talk afterwards. I'm curious now. I was a grad student at the University of Maryland until a couple of years ago, and there's a fairly large group of people that are working on graphene, and I didn't realize it had actually been invented while I was a student there. So it wasn't invented at Maryland, I should say that, but while I was there, that's when the field started taking off. So that's your physics news of the week. Oh, yeah, question.
Do you know how it conducts electricity? Is it across the plane, or is it, would you mention several layers and then we go?
I believe it goes across, but this gentleman here seems to know a lot about it, so I'm going to talk to him afterwards. I actually don't know for sure, but anyway, maybe we can talk about that, a little bit next week also. All right, so it's a little after 11 o'clock now, so I'll get started on today's lecture. So today. Today is about, I titled it medical physics. Now that's kind of an overly broad title. Medical physics is actually a huge field. You can get a PhD in medical physics. You can specialize in various types of medical physics. It's really broad. I'm not going to do it justice talking about it in an hour. So what I am going to do is talk about how particle physics has contributed to medicine in two ways. And helped us to develop two diagnostic tools. One of them is positron emission tomography, PET scans, and the other one is magnetic resonance imaging, or MRIs. I think probably just about everyone has heard of these two technologies, but I was actually surprised myself to find out how much particle physics was able to impact these two things. So where are these impacts coming from? PET technology, positron emission tomography, is at its core, it's based around these two tools from particle physics. One of them I'm showing here as an example is a sodium iodide crystal. This is something called a scintillator. We're going to talk about what that means and how it works. And then the next bit is a photomultiplier tube. This is these two things together, you can detect high energy photons. You can detect high energy little bits of light or gamma rays. You can detect X-rays also. The next bit with MRI technology, The core of how an MRI works is a really strong superconducting magnetic field, at least in most MRIs now. And what you're looking at here is a superconducting magnet from the experiment that I work on, Atlas. And we use the high magnetic field to bend the paths of charged particles. If you remember last week, charged particles will move in a straight line unless you put them in a magnetic field, and then they'll bend. And you can do a couple of things with this bending. The things that we use it for in my experiment are bending the particles and trying to measure their momentum based on the radius of curvature, based on how stiff those tracks are. But you can also use magnets, like we talked about last week, as part of a synchrotron, as part of a particle accelerator. It turns out superconducting magnets in particular are really useful for that. So that relates to MRI technology. So for the first part of the lecture, we're going to talk about PET scans. And to do that, we need to talk about antimatter. And some of you might recognize this from Star Trek. Antimatter is one of the ways they propel the Enterprise. And a lot of people that I've talked to are surprised to hear that antimatter actually exists. Now, probably some of you in this crowd are better informed, so many of you probably knew this already. But antimatter does exist. If you've seen Angels and Demons or read the book, it's there's a big plot structure based around antimatter. So antimatter does actually exist. So what is it? Well, I showed this last week. We know that an atom is made up of protons, neutrons, and electrons. And for most purposes, this is all you need to know to cover all of the structure that we're familiar with. Everything around us is basically made up of these three things. And although the neutrons and the protons have smaller parts to them, there's still only two different parts. So you've still got three fundamental particles explaining just about everything around us. But it turns out every fundamental particle has its own antithesis. It has an antimatter counterpart. And this was first hypothesized by physics theorist Paul Dirac, who was actually awarded the Nobel Prize in 1933 for predicting the positron, the positive electron, in 1928. All right, now why did he win the prize just so soon after 1933? Because Carl Anderson got the Nobel Prize in 1936 for actually detecting the positron. And you can notice the dates here. This guy detected it in 1932, and then the next year, Dirac got the Nobel Prize. So the committee does wait around to make sure that something interesting is going to happen. Dirac kind of lucked out. There's other Nobel Prizes that have been awarded 40 years after the research was done, since they wanted to make sure that the impact was going to be there. I should say right off the bat, actually, I started off talking about Nobel Prizes. I've mentioned two already in this lecture. I'm going to be mentioning quite a lot of Nobel Prizes. I want to give you guys a sense of all of the really important fundamental physics works that is going into these technologies that I'm talking about. It might seem a little over the top today, but there are so many pieces that had to come together to make these medical diagnostic tools that I'm talking about. So Dirac predicted the positron, the first antimatter particle detected. Anderson actually did detect it. So what is antimatter? It's got the same mass as the matter particle that corresponds to it. The only major difference is that you flip the electrical charges. The electron has negative charge, the positron has positive charge. There's also the antiproton, which has negative charge. And there's also a tricky one, the antineutron. Even though it has no electrical charge, so you can't flip that, it has charges, in a sense, related to the other forces, the strong and weak nuclear force. I'm not going to go into too much detail on that, but you can imagine flipping those from positive to negative and vice versa as well. They're just not electric charges. So what happens when matter and antimatter collide? Any suggestions?
Annihilation,
yeah. Got a picture of that here. Yeah, so this is kind of a cartoon of an electron and a positron coming together. And they annihilate, and the only thing left over is pure energy. Now, I say pure energy, but we never actually see pure energy in the lab. We only see the products of what you can make with that energy. And for matter and antimatter collisions, you almost always get two photons, two bits of light, gamma rays. So that's what happens when these things annihilate. What's going to be important for understanding how PET scans work is we have to know how much energy is released when you make these photons. And to talk about that, I'm going to need to introduce you to a unit of energy that we use all the time in my field. It's called the electron volt. Now, units of energy that you've probably heard of are calories. That's typically the energy that you see released from food. Of course, you see that on your food packages. There's the international standard unit, joules, that you may have heard of. What you've certainly heard of is a unit of power that's based on joules. You've heard of watts. That tells you how many joules you're using over a certain amount of time. So it tells you how much energy you're using. What I'm talking about here now is a very tiny unit of energy called the electron volt. And so I'll tell you what it is and then try to give you some sense of how much it is. So what's the definition? It's defined in terms of kinetic energy. This is energy relating to the motion of something. And we're going to talk about relating it to the motion of an electron. So an electron volt is the amount of kinetic energy that an electron picks up as it goes through one volt. And so what does this mean? Well, if you take a 9-volt battery, hook it up to two metal plates, so you've got the negative plate up here and the positive plate down here, and you put an electron here at the negative plate, well, this is negative, the electron's negative, so it's going to be repelled. The electron's going to want to go towards the positive plate, and that's what happens. And as it does that, it's going to pick up some energy, and it's going to pick up exactly 9 electron volts of energy, because you've got an electron, you've got 9 volts here, and so you basically multiply these two things together, in a sense, and that's how much kinetic energy it picks up. So I've defined it in terms of an electron, but since this is a generic unit of energy, you can use it on all sorts of things. It's kind of like the Celsius temperature scale is defined in terms of water. 0 is at the point where water freezes, 100 is at the point where water boils. So that's how Celsius is defined, but you can measure the temperature of anything. And so it's a similar thing here. The electron volt is defined in terms of the energy of motion of an electron, but you can use this unit of energy to measure the energy of anything. So for comparison, the bits of light that are coming into our eyes, the visible light, photons in the visible range, have an energy of a few electron volts, like 1 to 3 electron volts. The X-rays that we talked about last week have about 1,000 times as much energy, and gamma rays have even more energy still. So why do we use this unit? It's useful for talking about energies on a really small scale, and that's the kind of work I do. And it's not just useful for energies, you can also talk about masses. We know about E equals mc squared, that's the energy of something is related to how much mass it has. And so we can talk about measuring the mass of an electron, or a proton, or a neutron. We can measure the mass in electron volts. And this is one of the very few equations I'm going to show you guys. I try to stay away from these in public lectures, but I think everyone can follow this. So the mass of an electron is about 9 times 10 to the minus 31 kilograms. And if you're doing calculations, you don't want to carry around all of these 10 to the minus whatever all over the place. It gets to be really burdensome. But what we can do is find the energy corresponding to the mass of this electron. And so I've written here E equals mc squared, but I've written the actual numbers here. So here's the mass, 9 times 10 to the minus 31. C squared, this is the speed of light squared. Once you multiply that out and do a unit conversion to get electron volts, you can look that up if you want. Should be on Google pretty readily. But if you convert that, you get just under 511,000 electron volts. And we'll write that as 511 keV, K for kilo. Throughout this lecture, I'm also going to refer to MeV, mega electron volts, or million electron volts. Sometimes I'll talk about GeV, giga electron volts. That's a billion. And I may even talk about, I think I'm going to mention TeV, which is a trillion electron volts. So there are these wide scales, and we abbreviate them using these numbers. It's kind of like carrying around these extra factors of 10 to the whatever, but at least least up to a billion and maybe a few, sorry, trillion and a few orders of magnitude beyond that, we have standardized letters that we use. So, all right, so why am I talking about all this? I want to get back to this matter, antimatter, annihilation. So now I'm going to show you this cartoon again, but I'm putting in the numbers. So if you imagine an electron and a positron approaching each other very slowly, so that they're almost not moving at all, this is my way of saying we can ignore their kinetic energy, and they just barely touch, that's going to release 1,022 kiloelectron volts. And all I've done here is I've added the energy corresponding to the mass of this guy and the energy corresponding to the mass of this guy. And that's it. They annihilate, and they turn into two photons. And since there's two of them, you just divide this energy by two again. Each photon is going to have 511 keV of energy when it comes out. And so this puts it in the range of gamma rays. These are fairly high-powered photons. So that's matter, that's antimatter. When they annihilate, you get photons. The next important thing for PET scans is going to be, all right, where do we get antimatter? One source of getting antimatter is in radioactive decays. In particular, nuclear beta decay is a process that can emit either an electron or a positron. Now, the nuclear beta decay that was first discovered was the kind where a neutron inside an atom gets converted into an electron, a proton, and something called an antineutrino. We're going to ignore this for this lecture, but I will talk about neutrinos next week. But for our purposes, this thing doesn't interact with anything. It just flies off, and we forget about it. So the important things here, for today's lecture at least, are the electron and the proton. So that's one form of beta decay. There's actually another type where it's kind of backwards. You can have a proton be converted into a positron, a neutron, and a neutrino. And so this is one source of antimatter, getting the positrons here from certain types of radioactive decay. The electron type might be more common, but it's this decay here that's going to make positron emission tomography possible. I mean, the name, you know, it's in the name of it, positron emission. So what sort of things give off beta decay? Hopefully you can see some of this, but if you can't, I'll read it for you. What I'm showing you here are different isotopes. These are things that undergo nuclear beta decay. And I'm giving you their half-lives here. The half-life tells you something about how long this radioactive element is going to stick around before it decays. And so you can see there's a really wide range here. I go from 27 seconds to 72,000 years, 2 hours, 57,000 years. Some of these you might have heard of, like carbon-14, for example, which has a half-life of 57,000 years. That long half-life makes it useful for dating really old organic material. There's also fluorine-18, which you may not have heard of, and I didn't before I started working on these lectures. This turns out to be really useful for PET scans, and part of the reason is that it only lives for about 2 hours or so. The other thing I'm showing here is that some of them emit electrons, some of them emit positrons. If you're far from the screen, you might not be able to see electrical charges here. Don't worry about it. And then I've also shown the maximum energy that these things release. You know, 4,600 MeV is kind of a lot, 1,200 is kind of a lot. You get down to fluorine-18, it's a little bit less, 600 keV. And then carbon-14 is relatively low energy. My only point in talking about all of these is just to give you an idea of the range of these parameters for different types of beta decay. They're really all over the place. So the last thing I'm going to talk about here before we actually get into PET scans is what's this half-life? It's defined as the amount of time it takes for half of your radioactive sample to decay. And so if you plot that, this is one of the few graphs I'm going to show you guys, you get something, this is called an exponential decay curve. And so let's say you're doing a PET scan, they give you a dose of fluorine-18 in some chemical, and I don't know how much they're going to give you, probably a few milligrams or maybe less, probably less than that, nanograms even. I don't know, I'm not a doctor of medicine at least. So they give you A, that's what I'm going to call it. Well, after one half-life, after 2 hours in the case of fluorine-18, there's going to half of it left. After 5 half-lives, after 10 hours, it's going to be about 3% left or so. So it's not that it all goes away after 1 half-life or several half-lives. It takes a while for that to completely get down to some negligible level. But so you can imagine, you know, having something with a half-life of 2 hours, that's going to make it useful for going to the doctor's office and getting some procedure done, because these things typically take, you know, a few hours. So we have positron emission. We know positrons annihilate with electrons and produce photons. And the next big important thing that we're going to need is, well, how do we detect those photons? Now, detecting photons, this is getting into my area of expertise. This is getting into particle physics territory. So one of the things we use to detect photons is this thing called a photomultiplier tube. This is what it looks like. They've gotten a little bit of a cross-section here, but if you want a diagram, this is actually what's going on inside. So how does a photomultiplier tube work? It's got this thing here at the front called a photocathode. That's just a thin strip of metal, basically. And when high enough energy photon or electron, I say high enough energy, it doesn't have to be much more than, say, visible light. But when one of those hits this photocathode, it's going to kick off an electron from this metal. And now what's inside this tube is a really high voltage. And so that electron is going to get accelerated. It's going to get sped up, and it's going to crash into one of these other metal sheets here. And the energy from that is going to release yet more electrons. They're going to crash into another sheet and another one. And this goes all down until you've got this shower of electrons created just from a little signal at the front here. And that shower of electrons creates your electrical signal down here, which you can then read out and digitize or record it on an oscilloscope or something like that. So this gets us part of the way there in terms of detecting photons. These machines, photomultiplier tubes, have been in use for a long time, well over 50 years, maybe even longer. Now, all that gives you, though, is kind of a yes-no. It gives you, you know, the electrical signal you get here gives you a little bit more than a yes-no answer, but it's easy to saturate this thing with enough energy. And we're talking about detecting gamma rays. And so that kind of energy is easily going to saturate this. You're not going to be able to read out the amount of energy that went in. You're just going to know that something hit there. So we need something that's going to break down the energy of these photons coming in. So how do we do that? It's a divide and conquer process, but you need a material that's going to allow you to divide up this energy. So what we do is we turn to these materials called scintillators. What you guys are looking at here are plastic scintillators, and what they're doing is basically taking ultraviolet light, in this case, and breaking it down and turning it into the visible light that you're seeing here. Visible light is lower energy than ultraviolet light. So a scintillator can be made up of a variety of materials. There's plastic here. I showed you a crystal at the beginning of the lecture. It's made out of something called sodium iodide. It's very similar to table salt chemically. But you can make a scintillator out of that. So how do these scintillators work? Well, as a photon passes into a scintillator, what it's going to do is interact with the electrons in there. It's actually going to collide with the electrons. And this is called actually the Compton effect, and it's the Compton that these lectures are named after. So I have to mention this guy. He won the Nobel Prize in 1927 for work done just a few years earlier showing that photons and electrons can actually interact as though both of them are particles and not necessarily waves. Up until the early 1900s, it was thought that light energy was only transmitted in waves. When you start talking about quantum mechanics, the difference between a wave and a particle gets kind of fuzzy. And so Compton actually helped to demonstrate that by showing that when electrons and photons interact, they can actually, in a sense, bounce off each other like billiard balls. And so what happens in this interaction is that the photon can actually lose energy. And what it's doing is, let's say it enters a scintillator crystal like this. Well, if this crystal is just kind of sitting on its own, most of its electrons are in what's called, sorry, not most of them, but the outermost electrons are in what's called the valence band. This is around each atom in the crystal. And when a photon comes in and starts bouncing off of these electrons, sometimes it gives them enough energy and kicks them up into one of these higher bins, the conduction bin, for example. And pretty quickly afterwards, it's going to fall back down. And when it falls down, it's going to release the energy that it gained. So what's happening is photon goes in, gives a little bit of its energy to one of these, to an atom in a crystal. And then that energy is released again in what we call scintillation light. And you have to have quite a lot of these interactions. You know, the photon is a few thousand, you know, in our case, 500,000 electron volts. And the difference here, this energy difference, is maybe only a few electron volts. So you have to have several hundred thousand collisions. But eventually, all of that energy can be bled away, channeled towards the photomultiplier tube, and it can just count how many low-energy photons does it see. And once you calibrate what your signal looks like for each photon, you can just say, all right, here's the signal I saw. That's how many photons were released here. And you add the energy of all of those photons together, and you get the energy of the original one. So in the late 1940s, that's when they developed these, they did a thorough study of crystals like sodium iodide, or in this case, this is actually a crystal that was part of the experiment that I worked on as a grad student. This is a crystal of cesium iodide. It's very chemically similar. These guys here are sodium iodide crystals used in an experiment called DALMA in Italy. You can also have liquid scintillator. This is chemically similar to cleaning fluid, actually. This is in what's called the Borexino neutrino experiment. And then finally, again, plastic scintillators can also do this divide and conquer and break down photon energy so you can measure how much was actually there. So now we have all of the ingredients to do PET scans. We have antimatter in the form of positrons. We know how positrons are emitted. We know that they interact with electrons and give you photons. And now we know how to measure the energy of those photons. So how do you actually make a PET scan? It's pretty simple. You take these scintillator crystals that I've been talking about, for example, sodium iodide, cesium iodide. You put them in an array, hook them up to these photomultiplier tubes so you can break down the energy of the incoming photons and measure that energy. And then you arrange this whole thing in several rings of detectors and then wrap it up in a box, basically. And this is what your PET scan looks like. So what do they actually do during a PET scan? Well, you get a dose of some radioactive tracer material, and the one that I'll talk about here is fluorine-18. They use that in a chemical called fluorodeoxyglucose. It's a type of sugar. You can imagine sugar is going to be useful to study the metabolism. You can see where is this sugar being processed, where is it being concentrated. Part of the reason that's useful for this kind of diagnosis is that cancer cells tend to be a lot hungrier than normal healthy cells. So if you see that the sugar is all being directed towards one specific point, you can say, well, all right, there might be cancer there. We might have to look at that a bit more detail. Another type of chemical they can use is carbon-11. You can make glucose out of that, again, for metabolism. You can make carbon dioxide. You can make something called palmitate, which is useful for imaging the heart muscle. So what happens? Well, the chemical goes in, and you wait some time for it to be processed through the body. And all the while, it's emitting positrons. That's what this picture is meant to show here. You have a glow of positrons coming out. So what are these positrons doing? Well, they're coming out of the radioactive decay. Let's say now these are the atoms of your body. And let's say this atom here, let's say that's one of the radioactive ones. So it emits a positron. That's this little blue guy here. It's going to bounce around. It's not going to be immediately captured by an electron because it's got some energy coming out of this radioactive decay. So it needs to bounce around a little bit before it loses that energy. You can imagine, you know, positrons and electrons are attracted to each other because they're different charges. But if the positron is moving too fast, it's just going to go right on by. And that's what's happening here. But as it goes on by, it does lose some of its energy. So it bounces around a little bit, finally gets down almost to no kinetic energy at all, almost not moving. And once it's going that slow, then it can be captured by an electron. They annihilate each other, and you get your two photons out. And this is your signal for the PET scan. So what you've got on a larger scale now, here's your patient. here's your photons coming up and hitting your detector, your scintillator crystal. And what you're looking for here to make sure that you've got the photons that you're interested in and not some other junk, some other photons just floating around, just photons everywhere. You're looking for a specific energy, 511 keV for each of them, and you're also looking for them to be nearly simultaneous. So once you get that signal, you've got basically a line of sight here. You can say, the positron, you know, our radioactive material is emitted somewhere, you know, in this part of the patient. And then you correlate that with information from all around, and this is a circular detector, and you can build up more of a three-dimensional image. Now, if you want to get really advanced, there's some detectors that can actually, that are sensitive enough to detect the time difference between this one and this one. Now, why would there be a time difference? Well, if your radioactive decay is close to the surface here, then your photon is going to arrive at this detector before it arrives at this one. But since light moves really fast, it moves about 1 foot per nanosecond, 1 foot per billionth of a second, you have to have very precise timing to get this difference. So you have to have a difference to within, you know, half a nanosecond or less to be able to measure where along this line the positron was emitted. But it's that technology is out there. That's another another way you can get information out of a PET scan. So,
excuse me.
Oh yes, question.
On that previous, when you annihilate an electron, that leaves a positive ion.
It does. Yeah.
What happens to it?
It ends up getting filled in with other electron that just happens to be around. It may chemically react. Part of the reason to this is where you kind of get into the art of how to administer these radioactive materials, because if there's enough of them, you know, you can hit an electron in some important molecule, like maybe part of your DNA, or something that's going to cause an unwanted chemical reaction if it gets ionized. And so that's part of the reason you need to keep the radioactive dose low enough that you don't, you know, you don't really affect the patient, but high enough so that you can actually see the signal. So it is kind of a balancing act. This is not, you know, you are getting a low dose of radiation when you get a PET scan, so it's not, you have to weigh the risks and the benefits. But yeah, once you create this positive ion, it's not the most stable situation. So it's going to react with something. All right. So then just to wrap up this subject, this is just to give you an idea of what we can see with PET scans. So for example, this is a PET scan done with fluorine 18 used in this glucose type molecule, and it's showing you metabolism. In a normal subject and somebody with a cocaine addiction, you can see the metabolism is really down in this brain, and also especially in the forward region, and that's something that that has been associated with addiction. There's also the more traditional detection of possible cancers. The PET scan is over in this upper right corner. There's different other types of scans that are being shown here as well, but. The important thing is this is actually an image of someone's bladder, and you can see there's this dark spot here. That's where you've got a lot of positrons being emitted. That's actually where a lot of their sugar tracer went. And so in this case, you can see that the cancer cells are have a lot higher metabolism than the healthy cells around them. So this person unfortunately needed some more diagnosis to find out what exactly was going on. But in this case, it turned out to be a tumor. So this is how PET scans work. The basic detection element is from particle physics, from using these crystals as scintillators to break down the energies of photons and detect them with photomultiplier tubes. The things we're trying to detect are positrons coming from a type of beta decay, and they're interacting with electrons in regular matter to annihilate and give you photons. You put all of that information together, and then you can get something like a PET scan. So that's the first part of the talk. That's how particle detectors have impacted at least one part of medical diagnosis. The next thing we're going to talk about is MRIs. It's another tool for diagnosis, but it works in a completely different way. What we're going to do is, I'll give you a quick introduction to it. The tool, MRI, was actually originally called nuclear magnetic resonance imaging. Although when they decided to start using this for medical tool, they decided to remove the term nuclear just to not scare people away. In fact, there's no radiation at all in nuclear magnetic resonance. The word nuclear at the beginning refers to the process of using atomic nuclei to tell you something about a patient. We're going to go into detail on how that works. So it doesn't use any radiation at all. What it does use are extremely high magnetic fields. So that's something to keep in mind. I had a gentleman who was talking to me right at the beginning saying he couldn't get an MRI because of shrapnel. And that's one of the things you have to worry about with these high magnetic fields is you don't want to image somebody who's had shrapnel or had pins put in them for other surgeries. But barring that, this can be a pretty useful diagnostic tool. Now, what I'm going to do here is not start with MRIs at all, but actually start a little bit down the road here at the Fermi Lab. This is just about an hour's drive away. Hopefully some of you had the opportunity to visit this lab. Fermilab has been around since the early 1970s. It was dedicated in 1974 as an accelerator, and this is the main acceleration right here. It accelerates protons up to an energy of 200 GeV, that's 200 billion electron volts. Sounds like a lot, and in the early 1970s it was a lot. Now the way this accelerator works, it's a synchrotron like we talked about last week. It's got alternating electric and magnetic fields getting stronger and stronger as you build up the energy. And they're getting stronger in sync. That's why it's called a synchrotron. And the magnetic fields, when this thing started, were generated by traditional electromagnets. I'll actually show you an electromagnet in a few minutes. But it's basically a way of making a magnet out of a coil of wire. And so that's what originally powered this main ring here of Fermilab. The goal in building this was to have a truly national laboratory. Labs up to that point had been fairly regional and not always offered unrestricted access to scientists who wanted to use their facilities. The whole goal of Fermilab, at the time it was being built, they called it the National Accelerator Lab. It was to have any qualified scientist who wanted to do some work there would be able to get some time and do their experiment. Now, from the beginning, the director, Robert Wilson, was thinking not in terms of a 200 GeV machine like it started off. He was thinking five times higher in terms of a 1 trillion electron volt machine, a 1 TeV machine, even in the late 1960s, early 1970s. They actually made quite a bit of progress. You know, this thing opened it was dedicated in 1974. I think they had been running for maybe a couple years before that. Started at 200 GeV. Within just 3 or 4 years, they doubled that to 400, and then a little bit later up to 500 GeV. And that's where it was in 1976. It kind of leveled off. Well, in 1977, Robert Wilson, the director, went to Congress and said, you know, if we can transition this ring here to superconducting magnets instead of regular electrical conduction in the magnets, we can double the energy, we can make a 1 TeV machine, and we can cut the electricity bill in half. And part of the way that works, when we talk about superconductivity, you'll see why you can cut the electricity bill in half. So that's what we're going to talk about now, is how does superconductivity work? Well, first of all, what is it? All right, what you're looking at here is a cartoon of what a metal looks like. You have your positive atomic nuclei arranged in kind of a lattice. And you have electrons that can flow somewhat freely through that metal. The fact that these electrons are free to move around is what makes metals conductive in the first place. It's why you can conduct electricity across a wire or a sheet of metal. But these electrons are not completely free. What's happening is, you know, sometimes they're scattering off of this lattice or they're scattering off of each other. And what that ends up doing is in a sense, it builds up friction. You get heat generated, you get electrical resistance. So even though normal metals are good at conducting electricity, they all have some resistance, and if you pass enough electric current through them, they're eventually going to heat up. Well, in the early 1900s, the very early 1900s, this gentleman, Kamerlingh Ohms, discovered superconductivity. He got the Nobel Prize for it in 1913 for discovering superconductivity and also for producing liquid helium. Now, liquid helium is extremely cold. It's only a few degrees, I think 4 degrees above absolute zero. But you need to make metals that cold if you're going to make them superconducting. What he found was when you cool these metals down far enough, he was using mercury in the original experiments, mercury and gold as well. He found that once you get past a certain temperature below, a little bit below 4 degrees above absolute zero, the metal completely loses all resistance. Before that, the resistance had been going down, you know, steadily, and then all of a sudden it just drops off. And that was the transition to superconduction. So what that means, for example, is if you have a loop of wire and you put a current in that loop, if this wire is superconducting, that current is just going to keep going around and around indefinitely because in superconductivity or in a metal that's superconducting, there's no resistance whatsoever. It's not losing any energy to the atom. The explanation for this was actually elusive for about 40 years. It took quantum mechanics to come up with an explanation for how superconductivity works. Now, explaining anything that uses quantum mechanics is kind of tough, but I'll try to give you guys a flavor of it. It's hard for us to wrap our brains around it because we're not used to dealing with quantum concepts on an everyday scale. But this is roughly how it works. So I'm going to show you the lattice of a metal again. And what I've done here is I've removed all of the electrons. Now, you should imagine the electrons still here. The reason I've taken them away is because I want to focus on just two electrons in this metal. So here's your metallic lattice. And you've cooled it down now to just a few degrees above absolute zero. What that means is that these nuclei here are not vibrating around so much as they are at, say, room temperature. As you get colder and colder, these things are vibrating less and less. Now, when an electron goes by in this extremely cold metal, it's going to deform this lattice a little bit. I've kind of overemphasized it here, but you've got say, these two positive atomic nuclei becoming essentially getting closer to each other as this electron goes by because they're attracted to the electron's negative charge. All right, now what's happening here? You've got a higher positive charge now, and so some electron that's sitting over here is going to want to go towards that. So that's what ends up happening. So what's really happening here is that these two electrons are, in a sense, communicating with each other. And the way they're able to do this is because there aren't so many thermal vibrations washing out that communication. Once it's cold enough, you can actually send, in a sense, messages back and forth between electrons using the atomic lattice. So, and you'll notice that these are now going in the same direction. This is an attractive force. Electrons normally repel each other because they're both negative, but when they communicate in this way, it's attractive. So what you've got here now is a situation where you've got the electrons and the lattice of the metal coupled together. They're working as a single unit. It doesn't necessarily make sense to think of them as separate objects anymore. And the fact that they're all coupled and working together means that electrons now can pass through this metal without any of the resistance it had before. Everything is operating coherently as a single unit. So that's roughly, very roughly, how superconductivity works. I'm just trying to give you a flavor of it. Now, the theory for how this works was actually developed not far from here. These three gentlemen were at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. They developed this theory in 1957 and were awarded the Nobel Prize in 1972, right around the time that superconductivity was really starting to take off. All right, so what does this have to do with MRIs? Now we need to know how MRIs work. So we're going to start with the word that's been banned from MRIs. We're going to start with the nucleus. And we're going to use a hydrogen nucleus. Hydrogen is the simplest element, and its nucleus is just a single proton. I'm going to go over here and turn on my demonstration because we're going to need this in just a couple of minutes. And the projector takes a little while to start up. So, All right, so we've got this atomic nucleus, and one of the funny things about quantum mechanics is that it tells us all of these fundamental particles, protons, neutrons, electrons, quarks, they all have something called spin. They all behave as if they're spinning. Now, in the case of a proton, this is something that does have some size associated with it. The proton itself is not fundamental. But I could just as easily replace this with an electron. The electron has something called spin as well. And it's hard to imagine something spinning if it's got no size associated with it. But as far as we can tell, the electron and other fundamental particles like quarks really don't have any size, at least to the precision of our experiments. Regardless, they do have spin. So you can imagine these things, for the purposes of this lecture at least, you can imagine them like they're spinning spinning balls. And I'll show you a spinning billiard ball in a couple of minutes. So what happens when you have this charged object now? It's got an electrical charge on it, and it's got some spin associated with it. Well, that makes it behave kind of like a little magnet. It's exactly the same as if this were the North Pole, and what I'm showing here is the magnetic field around this object. So with the nuclei spinning and behaving like a magnetic field, well, what's going to happen if you put this in a larger magnetic field? Well, this spin axis, this north pole, is going to try to align with that magnetic field, just like a compass does inside the Earth's magnetic field. The north part of it always points north, and what it's doing is it's aligning itself with the external magnetic field. So we can do that with atomic nuclei also. We can put them inside a magnetic field. So let's say you take a person now, put this person inside of a large magnetic field, really strong. I'm talking more than 30,000 times the Earth's magnetic field, so more than one Tesla of magnetic field strength. Well, what's going to happen is some of these hydrogen nuclei are going to behave like little compasses. They're going to try to align themselves inside this larger magnetic field. Now, because people are not very magnetic, and these hydrogen atoms are not terribly magnetic themselves, you're only going to actually get about one in a million lining up this way, even in a one Tesla strength magnetic field, 30,000 times the Earth's magnetic field. But one in a million is enough. Now, even though these hydrogen nuclei are now what we call polarized, they're all pointed in the one in a million, at least, are all pointed in the same direction, they're not perfectly aligned with the magnetic field. And that makes them undergo a process called precession. And that's what I've got this demonstration here for. So hopefully, you can see the screen fairly well. What I've got here is a billiard ball. And you can imagine this billiard ball as being like a hydrogen nucleus. Now, something special about this particular ball, it's got a permanent magnet in it. So you can see this little black pointer sticking out of it. That tells you which way north it is. So I've got this hydrogen nucleus that's spinning on its axis, so it's got a magnetic field, and now you know where the top of it is, you know where the spin axis is, so you know where north is. The other ingredient here is these coils. This is an electromagnet. It's basically just some wound, looks like copper wire. And so you can see you've got a magnet here. I'm going to put an external magnetic field on it, and you should see something happen. So let's turn that on. There we go. So it's trying to align itself in this magnetic field. And I heard somebody whisper just now, it's precessing. Yeah, what does that mean? All right, so what I'm going to do is I'll turn off the magnetic field temporarily. And I'm going to set this guy spinning. So let me try to smooth it out. Okay, so now it's spinning. If I start cranking up the magnetic field, it would help if I turned it on. There we go. Now it's doing something. This is what precession is. This is what I wanted to show you guys in terms of a demonstration and not words, because it's really hard to describe what's going on here. But it's easy to see. You've got your little magnetic field, that's where the black marker is, pointed in one direction. You've got your external magnetic field, in this case pointed up towards the ceiling. And so it's actually spinning around that. It's going through this precession process. And this precession here, the speed at which it's going around, the frequency at which it's going around, depends on the strength of the magnetic field. So if I crank it up a little bit, you can see that it's going faster now. And this is exactly analogous to what I'm going to talk about in a minute or two with MRIs. If you put a hydrogen nucleus in some magnetic field, it's going to precess around that magnetic field. And if you change the strength of that field, if you crank it up or down, that's going to change the frequency here. All right? Let me turn this off. And we might have some time at the end if people want to see this in a little more detail. But imagine, just remember what you saw there. That was this billiard ball itself. Think of that as the hydrogen nucleus. Yes, I'll let you know. Okay. And that process is called precession. All right. Oh, and I should say precession was described by Joseph Larmor in 1897. He described the mathematical equations for this. It doesn't just apply to magnets and atomic nuclei. It applies to anything like a gyroscope. If you've seen a gyroscope spinning around, it's exactly the same principle. All right, so we're going to take a person, put them in a strong magnetic field, and now you've got your hydrogen nuclei. I lost my laser pointer. So you've got your 1 in a million hydrogen nuclei now aligned in that magnetic field. And remember, they're not perfectly aligned, so they're actually precessing around that magnetic field. And the heart of how MRIs work is that the frequency that they're spinning around is unique for each atomic nucleus. So for hydrogen, the speed is about 40 megahertz, 40 million times spinning around per second per unit strength of magnetic field. So if we have a 1 Tesla magnetic field, 30,000 times the Earth's magnetic field, they're going to be going around at 40 megahertz. So, all right, how do we take this and do something useful with it? Well, we can try to add energy. What happens if we try to add energy at exactly the same frequency that these things are spinning at? You know something's going to happen. If you imagine pushing somebody on a swing, if you give them a push at just the right frequency as they're coming towards you, you know, right at the top, you give them a push, that adds energy to the system. You're not gonna like stand in the middle and just push like this. That's not gonna go anywhere. You have to do it at just the right frequency. So what we want to do is add energy to the system using the frequency of these nuclei, and that works out to like 50 megahertz. Well, all right, what do we know that vibrates at 50 megahertz? Radio waves, for example. We can launch a radio wave into these nuclei, and what's gonna happen? It'll absorb the radio wave, and it'll actually use that energy to flip. It's going to go against the magnetic field. And after some time, after you turn off the radio wave that's giving it this energy, after a little bit of time, it's going to flip back and release the energy that you gave it. So what does this look like if you put a radio detector next to your machine? Well, at the beginning, you pump in a lot of radio energy, and a bunch of these atoms have flipped. They're going against the field. And you turn it off and wait for that for them to start flipping back. And as they do, they flip back and they release the radio wave that you gave them, basically. They release that energy. And so you get this frequency here. This is the frequency that you had excited it with. And it's dropping off as a function of time. So that's your signal of how MRIs actually work. And this process of communicating with atomic nuclei using radio waves was developed by Felix Bloch and Edward Purcell. He got the Nobel Prize in 1952 for the development of the nuclear magnetic resonance method, this method of using radio waves to communicate with atoms. All right, so that's part of the story. The next question is, well, how do you know where this atom is? If you're seeing a signal at just one single frequency, all you know is that, say, a hydrogen nucleus was there somewhere in your machine. You don't know where it was necessarily. So the next part of it is actually pretty clever. You can actually vary the strength of the magnetic field across your sample, say across the person inside the MRI. So you have less of the magnetic field on this side and more of a magnetic field on this side. Now, because the frequency that these hydrogen nuclei are precessing at depends on the magnetic field, you know that over here you're going to have a lower frequency, say a little bit less than 50 megahertz, and over here you're going to have a higher frequency, a little bit more than 50 megahertz. And you put your radio wave in on across this frequency range, and then you see what comes out. And depending on what frequency you get, that tells you where along this line the hydrogen nucleus actually was. You can take this whole setup now and rotate it in three dimensions now around your patient. And using that, analyzing those signals with a computer, you can build up a three-dimensional map of the distribution of hydrogen in this person's body. And I keep talking about hydrogen because that's in just about every one of our molecules. Hydrogen is all over the place. It's in water, it's in oil-type cells or fat cells, or I should say, yeah, fat cells, and DNA, it's all over the place. So this technique now of varying this magnetic field and actually using that information to make an image was developed by these guys, Paul Lauterbur and Peter Mansfield, who had the Nobel Prize just a few years ago, 7 years ago, for the magnetic resonance imaging technique. All right, so now to get this whole process started, you need a magnet. And we're running short on time, so I'm gonna breeze through this part a little bit. There, you can imagine different types of magnets. So there's permanent magnets. You can make an MRI out of those, but you get a fairly low magnetic field strength overall, and you get a very heavy MRI, 90 tons. So you can use regular electromagnets, like the type I used right here. That was a regular electromagnet generating the magnetic field. It's a coil of wire. In that case, you can make a much smaller magnet. It weighs only about 4 tons. But you still don't get much more of a maximum magnetic field. You're limited by the resistance of this metal, by this metal heating up. And so then you can go to superconducting magnets. This is where Fermilab starts playing a role now. What you guys are looking at here is the amount of regular electric cable that would need to conduct 12,500 amps of current. And here is the same amount of superconducting cable that you would need for the same thing. So not only are superconducting electromagnets much smaller, they can give you much higher field strengths because you can just keep pumping current into this thing, and it's not going to lose any energy. So superconducting electromagnets for an MRI give you a factor of 10 better magnetic field uniformity. They give you much better, much higher possible magnetic field strengths. They're a bit heavier now, not because of the material that you have to use, that's actually pretty light, but you have to put in this huge cooling system using liquid helium to cool it down. So that's why your MRI machines still look fairly big, because they have this cryogenic refrigeration system. So what does this have to do with Fermilab? Well, at the time that this thing was conceived, these days it's called the Tevatron because it can supply a TeV, trillion electron volts of energy. In the early 1970s, when this thing was still using regular magnets, the world's supply of superconducting materials was only about a few hundred pounds per year. That's how much they were producing in the early 70s. Now, when Robert Wilson wanted to upgrade this thing to use electromagnets, this ring is 4 miles around. It turned out they would need 135,000 pounds over the course of 1974 to 1983. And again, the annual production was only a few hundred pounds. So how do you go to the industry and say, hey, we need, there was this story that physicist Paul Reardon went to the Teledyne Huacheng Albany Corporation in Oregon, which was one of the only major suppliers at the time. They said, well, how much is it by the ton? These guys are producing a few hundred pounds a year. They were just kind of shocked. And he said to his colleagues, if you ask for it by the pounds, you're not going to get the amount you need. You have to make them think big. So how do you go to your manufacturers and convince them to produce cable at much higher rate? Well, Fermilab, it had created a near overnight demand, but it needed a way to satisfy that demand. So it actually made these kits. They called it the Fermilab kit that they would give to companies that were producing superconducting material. And this kit showed them, this is how we want you to make the wire for our magnets. It's got everything you need. You just supply the materials and put it together with this kit that we're giving you. At one point during the late 1970s, early 1980s, Fermilab had bought over 95% of all of the niobium titanium alloy ever produced since the beginning of time. I mean, they were really the only customer here, but they were a huge customer. So eventually, using these kits, they got other suppliers online and making superconducting material, showing them how to use these kits. All right, so what did Fermilab do with these? They put these together. This is actually not a Fermilab magnet. This is a magnet for the Large Hadron Collider that I work on, but the principle is the same. They put together the superconducting magnet. Fermilab needed, for each magnet, Fermilab needed 110,000 feet of wire, which was kind of braided together. Is it braided? Well, it was woven together somehow into 4,600 feet of cable. They eventually had to make, remember, the ring was 4 miles around. They had to make just under 800 of these magnets used for bending the protons around the ring, and another 200 magnets that were used for focusing that beam. All right, so what does this have to do with MRIs? Well, when Fermilab started buying the superconducting material, it was about $100,000 a ton. Now, modern MRIs didn't exist at the time, but even if they did, that high cost, you know, $100,000 a ton, you're not going to make something and put it in a physician's office. Fermilab's Tevatron created a huge market for this almost overnight, and they had this market. They maintained this market throughout the 1970s. They showed manufacturers how do you make superconducting cable, how do you make superconducting magnets, and then when MRI, when the computer technology required to interpret MRIs arrived in the early 1980s, there was this huge market there now to supply superconducting magnets that they needed for MRIs. So that in that kind of roundabout way, that's how Fermilab kind of stimulated the market for superconducting magnets. So, all right, so we're at the end here. So today we discussed two ways in which basic research into high energy physics impacted medical diagnostic technology. On the particle detection side, we talked about how scintillators like this crystal here can be combined with photomultiplier tubes to eventually take an image of radioactive tracer going through somebody's body. And then on the particle acceleration side, we saw how the huge demand created by Fermilab's appetite for superconducting material primed the industry for making superconducting magnets for MRIs when those came along. So thanks for your attention. They tend to be black and white images, and how light or how dark an image is at a certain point tells you how much hydrogen is in that part of the image.
So just like variations in the amount of hydrogen in tissue, you go from a little bit of tissue to another little bit of tissue,
yeah.
And that gives all that detail you see.
Yeah, as far as I understand, at least my limited understanding of this technology, yeah. So a couple more questions, yes.
What do you know about the patent regime that surrounds all of the superconducting magnets?
Patents. As far as I know, at least the part that Fermilab was working on, I don't think that was patented. This is actually something I know very little about. I don't know that there are any patents on the basic technology. There are probably tons of patents on applications of that technology, but the basic part, I don't know for sure. All right, we've got time maybe for one more question. Is that one? Yes, in the back.
Yeah. You mentioned there might be deleterious effects to the PET scan. Is
sure.
There anything comparable to that in the MRI scan?
So, as far as I know, there hasn't been anything that tells you that the magnetic fields used in MRIs are in any way harmful. We're talking of fields of maybe 1 or 2 tesla. When you do start getting the higher and higher magnetic fields, I have heard of research saying that some strong magnetic fields can have an impact on the brain, but I've seen some studies about how it can maybe influence emotions a little bit or make you more paranoid or something like that. But these are even higher magnetic fields than they're using in MRIs. As I understand it, this technology is fairly safe, except, of course, if you've got metal anywhere near it, then you're in trouble. I'll be here for questions afterwards, but it's just afternoon, so I'll release you guys. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.